Good morning, everyone. Again, this is John Pendleton. I'm your trainer today, and we're going to cover a little bit of general geothermal unit installations on Enertech units. So it'll basically cover a lot of our units here, probably about 45 minutes or so. This training is today. Again, it will be recorded. So if you would like to check out the recording later, you can visit our YouTube channel. It's Enertech University. All of our webinars are uploaded there once we get them done. So there's quite a few videos on there. Feel free to check those out. There's who I am. Again, John Pendleton. I'm the trainer. I also work back in technical support. I'm really working on some new equipment that we're getting ready to release. So I'm not in tech support too much, but I am available. Here's my direct line and my email. And the second number there listed, the 5860, is will ring back to a pool back in tech support. So if you call that number, you can definitely ask for me and they'll transfer you to me if I'm available. If you need any training, if you're looking for any in-person trainings or to set some type of training up, please feel free to reach out to me. So once you get the unit, no matter what type of unit it is, whether it's a water-to-water unit, packaged unit, make sure you always check it for shipping damage. I know a lot of times as a technician, you don't see the unit until you're ready to install it. And it could have sat in your office for a month or so. But once you do get it, you open it up and take the plastic off and all that, just make sure there's no shipping damage. Make sure the doors, there's not any dents or dings in the doors, which would be an obvious sign that there might be something wrong internally. Make sure you have the right unit. I'd hate to have you install a 5-ton when you need a 3-ton unit. So make sure you got the correct unit. We've really only got 5 days to report freight damage. So the quicker we can know about that, the better. Now, if you get out to the job and you do have shipping damage, still give us a call, even if it is after that 5 days. We will take care of it one way or another, whether we have to file it through warranty or file a claim with the shipping company. But just please let us know. Take some pictures. You can email me the pictures. You can email them to tech services. That way we've got those for a claim for freight damage or through warranty. Make sure you keep the unit in the upright position. The horizontal unit is the only unit that really, I guess, would lay down because that's its normal position. But all the others have a compressor in them, so we don't want to lay it down and that oil runs out of the compressor. It doesn't have any oil when we go to start it up. Don't stack them more than too high in your warehouse. Don't store them outside. The only unit that can be stored outside is the RT outdoor split unit. That's the only unit we really have for an outdoor installation. So it's the only unit that's made for, it's made to protect it against the weather and the elements. So don't store them outside. And due to the weight, make sure you're using good quality hand trucks. Make sure they've got probably pneumatic tires on it. If you've got a stair climber, that's even better. But the units are around 400 to 500 pounds. They've got a couple of heat exchangers and a compressor in the bottom of the unit. There's a lot of weight in the bottom of the unit. So just be careful when you're picking them up. I know I've hurt my back trying to move them around before. So just be careful when you're moving them around. They are quite heavy. Obviously, we got to make sure we've got the correct unit. There are a couple of shipping brackets, and I'll show you a picture of those here in just a minute, that need to be removed. And if you don't remove those brackets, you'll probably know it when you go to start it up. Check the electrical connections. It's even the factory in connections. There could be some loose wires during shipment, especially on the contactor. Sometimes those will come loose during shipment. So check the factory wiring, make sure it's all tight. Make sure there's nothing wrong with the copper tubing. Your compressor is not laying in the bottom of the cabinet sideways for some reason. But just look at the refrigerant piping. One thing I would look at if you think about it, is make sure that there's a equalizer tube, or the equalizer tube as well as the bulb for the thermal expansion device, the TXV. And I've seen sometimes where the bulb line rubs on the equalizer line and then one or the other gets a hole in it. So that usually would happen during shipment. So just check that those lines, if you think about it, and make sure that they're not rubbing anything. If you know you're going to install the unit tomorrow, get the manual out of it and take a look at it. There's some stuff that we need to do to set it up on initial startup. And if you don't do it, it could cause the unit to lock out prematurely. So just check out the manual. I'm not saying you got to read every single word in the manual, but I would definitely browse through it and take a look and see, you know, if there's any little nuances that you're not used to, that'll definitely make your install go quicker and your startup go smoothly. This is one of the blower brackets that I was talking about. It's on the shaft of the blower, on the opposite side, obviously, as the module or the head of the motor. And if you do not take this bracket off when you start up the blower, you'll know it pretty quickly. It'll be super loud, so you'll go to investigate and you'll see that you just forgot to take that off. There's a couple 3/8 screws to hold it in, and you can just take those bolts out in that metal piece and just recycle it. On some of the units, there's also what we call an M bracket underneath the squirrel cage or the blower housing that kind of allows it. So if for some reason the blower were to drop during shipment, it would hit that and hold it up. If for some reason you do not take that M bracket out underneath it, it may or may not make noise. So you may not even know it. Over time, it probably would make noise. So it needs to be removed, but you may not notice it on initial startup. But this bracket right here, you'll hear it. It's this metal on metal, basically. Compressor shipping bolts, all of our compressors sit on a isolation bracket, and the two bolts that are, or the nuts that are circled there, those need to be loosened up, and they'll raise that silver plate that that compressor is sitting on up just a little bit. And there's some isolation pads underneath that silver plate that the compressor sits on. And it just allows that compressor to move a little bit, like if it's got any kind of, you know, vibration or anything, it just allows it to kind of vibrate there a little bit on that isolation bracket and cause noise issues. So you can just loosen those up. You don't have to take them all the way off. The compressor feet, those bolts can stay tightened in there. We don't need to loosen those from the plate itself, just those two middle nuts there. Check for any loose or broken wiring, especially, again, like I said, on the contactor and any kind of screw terminal. So the ECM board, I would probably check those silver screw, Phillips head screws there, and obviously the contactor. Refrigerant piping, make sure it's not kinked, dented, make sure that equalizer tube and bulb line are not rubbing on anything as well. Inside the unit, there'll be an installation manual. If you can't get to an installation manual, but you need one, we do have we have a secure site you can go to where you'd have to register, but you can also go to the brand of the unit that you have. So if it's a GeoComfort unit, you can go to geocomfort.com. If it's a hydrant module, you can go to hydrantmodule.com. Or if it's Techco, you can go to techco.com. Once you get on there, you can click on products and then click on, if it's a residential commercial, you can click on residential commercial, and then it'll bring up pictures of the units. And it'll say like a YT unit or a HT unit or a ZT unit. You can click on a picture of that unit, and then it'll bring up all the documents, and you can pull up a manual there and download it. They're pretty easy to get to. So if you can't get to the manual inside the unit, you can always go online. You can always call us in tech support, and we'll send you a PDF of it as well. So whichever works best for you. There are some, there's a the superheater kit if you order the unit with a de-superheater, and we'll cover that de-superheater kit here in just a few minutes of what comes in that kit. There's some duct flanges for the supply on the YT, VT, HT, and also on the return as well. There's a condensate tube for the YT packaged unit. The YT packaged unit is probably our most common unit right now. And it has a condensate that comes out in the middle of the drain pan. So it comes down through like the compressor section, and then we'll go to either the left or right corner post. There's a little white or clear vinyl tubing that'll run to that corner post. And then you can run to the corner post and then do your trapping outside of the unit. The control box will come inside of the blower housing portion. It'll be strapped to the corner post of the usually the front, what we call the front of the unit, the door with the sticker on the front of it, the brand on it. The control box will be inside of there in a little bag and strapped to the side. There's also a filler plate for the YT unit. The YT unit, if you've ever dealt with our older XT packaged unit, we set the control box on top of the unit and then it plugged into some Molex connectors and hooked into the lower section. Well, we had some issues with sometimes those connectors would get loose or not make good contact. So on the YT packaged unit, we hardwired it. So when we did that, we had to make that hole a little bit bigger on the top of the unit. And so we could pass that control box through that hole and set it on top. So once we do that, then there's a little gap on the back side of that control box, and there's a filler plate with insulation on the bottom of it that'll fill in that hole. So it'll come with that filler plate inside of the bag with your duct flanges and your condensate tube. Obviously, there could be numerous power sources for the unit if you have electric backup heat. So just make sure you've got the power disconnected, or you know that there's power and you're being careful in there before you go sticking your hands inside that unit. Most of you guys are probably pretty familiar with that, is working on high voltage equipment quite often. Do not use the unit for heating or cooling during construction. Any kind of sheetrock dust, any kind of lacquers or anything like that could get on that air coil inside the unit and then cause issues with the air heat exchanger or the air coil. Those, we are using micro channel air coils, and when they get dirty with, you know, sheetrock dust or construction debris, it's really kind of hard to clean them. You can't really put a garden hose on it that's in somebody's house. So they're just a little bit more difficult to clean. We're not supposed to use chemicals on them. So no coil cleaners on those micro channel air coils. So you're probably, in order to clean it, you're probably gonna have to remove it from the unit and take it outside and be able to, you know, blow water through it. You can try to vacuum them if they do get dirty, but you may have luck, you may not. So the best option is to not use it during construction. It can void the warranty. So if, you know, the drywallers say, well, we got to have it warm in here, then they need to get some turbo heaters or find some other way of heating up that building. We just don't want to use it during construction. Some of the key electrical components of the unit. We have a contactor just like any other heat pump or AC unit. We're using a transformer, and the transformer does come from the factory wired for the 230 volt or 240 volt. If you have 208 volts, we don't see that real often, but occasionally we do. You will need to switch the taps on the transformer. Otherwise, your secondary voltage out of the transformer will be off. We're using basically one lockout board basically in all of our units. Now they may look a tiny bit different, but a lot of the logic is the same and the faults are pretty much very consistent across our line. So once you kind of figure out our lockout board, you know, you'll pretty much have it down for most of our units. We are, with the newer lockout board that we have now, we're going to flow thermistors where we're looking at refrigerant temperature. But anytime a unit has a brazed plate heat exchanger, it's going to have a flow switch as well, which is that upper right picture there. It's basically just a little paddle switch in the water line. The water flow closes the switch. It's a normally open switch. So it closes that switch off and lets us know that we have flow. The reason we're going more towards thermistors is because the flow switch doesn't actually give us proper flow. You know, if we've got a 10 ton unit, that flow switch closes at like 5 GPM. Well, 5 GPM on a 10 ton unit is not enough flow. It tells us we have flow. This doesn't tell us we have proper flow. So we're starting to go to thermistors and looking at refrigerant temperature and converting that over to, you know, our water. So we're actually looking at refrigerant temperature, not water temperature even. So, but that's kind of the route we're kind of going on that. But again, anytime you have a brazed plate bearing unit, it will have a flow switch. And that's because the brazed plate manufacturers require that. We also have pressure switches, high and low pressure switches. And if you ever have a pressure switch that fails in the field, as long as it's not leaking refrigerant, we'll send you a kit. And the kit will basically thread on to your suction or discharge service port. And it'll have a little T on there so you can thread on the pressure switch as well as still put your refrigerant gauges on the unit. So that way you don't have to take all the refrigerant out of the system just to change out a high pressure switch or a low pressure switch. So as long as it's not leaking refrigerant, file a warranty on the pressure switch and let them know that you want the, if you don't specify that it's leaking, we'll send you a kit. You specify that it's leaking refrigerant, then you can either try to fix it in the field or we'll send you a new one like what's in this picture here. It'll have a little shoulder on it where you can put it back into the copper pipe and braze it back on. We have a terminal strip in the upper left corner there. You can see on the bottom of that, like where it's got all the writing, the O, the Y1, Y2, R, C, that lower part can actually be removed. And so you can put your thermostat wires in there. You can actually wiggle that terminal strip off and you can jumper the unit out so you don't have to worry about the thermostat. Also, if you want, you can email me and I'll send you one of those terminal strips with some thermostat wiring on it so you can use it as a jumper. And so you don't have to run up and down the stairs waiting on that thermostat to satisfy its time delay. But just shoot me an email and with your address, and I will I'll drop one in the mail. I'll make one up for you and drop it in the mail for you. Reversing valve, it's pretty basic. Our reversing valve doesn't really shift a whole lot. The only time it really should shift is when it goes into cooling. And then once you take it out, once the thermostat, sorry guys. Let me fix that real quick. Sorry about that. I didn't realize I had my phone on. The reversing valve, it really doesn't switch other than when it goes into cooling for the first time. Once the thermostat is in cooling mode, it always has power to the O terminal. And we don't have a defrost cycle on our units. So the only way that the valve is gonna go back to heating is when you turn your thermostat to off or to heating mode. Once it goes into cooling, the O never does get de-energized. So our reversing valves are pretty reliable because we're not shifting them very often, usually once or twice a year. We don't really have a whole lot of issues with them. Just know that if you do have a refrigerant leak and you need to replace it, on some of our units, we offer what we call a spider assembly, and it'll come with it's got stubs on the valve itself, but but we'll braze copper into those couplings on the valve and stub it out, you know, 10, 12 inches. So you don't have to braze on it in the field. You can cut it where you need to and use some slip couplings and slide it into place. And you would have to recommend or ask for that. That's what's called a spider assembly. So if you file a warranty in the notes, just put that you'd like a spider assembly for the reversing valve. Fortunately, they don't fail very often. So because they are kind of a bear to replace. I've seen guys overheat them and melt them. And that's always a pain when you take out a reversing valve, put a new one in, you melt it, and then you got to replace it too. So, but I know you, I feel your pain. I mean, I was in the field for, you know, well over 20 years. So I've worked on a lot of stuff and I've had to change valves and I've overheated valves when I in my younger days. So I feel your pain. And when I started with Enertech, I kind of pushed for that because I did see guys burning up valves. So it happens, you know, you got to learn somehow. So it's not the end of the world, but kind of a pain in the butt. To the right is our thermal expansion valve. It is adjustable, but I wouldn't really recommend that you adjust it. It's usually set at the factory. So if you do want to adjust it, make sure that you know how many turns you turned it so you can go back to that point if need be. We have a lot of expansion valve failures in the field. Normally it's not the valve. There's nothing really in the valve that can really break other than it loses the bulb charge. But normally it's something in the refrigerant circuit that's gumming up the piston inside of that valve or has plugged up the equalizer tube and won't allow it, that piston to move up and down inside of it. You can actually take if you pull the refrigerant out of the circuit, you can take that second nut that's closer to the body on the TXV off. You can take the head off the valve as well, and you can pull that piston out. It's got a tapered portion right in the middle of it, and usually you'll see like a black sludge or maybe even a honey colored look to it. You can usually clean it off, put it back in, you know, pull a vacuum on the unit, recharge it, and it'll work just fine. It's not normally something that actually breaks, other than we could have the bulb line rub a hole in it and then lose your bulb charge, and then it won't shift, or yeah, it won't open and close the valve. Most of our blowers are an ECM blower motor. And in this picture, it's not real clear, but where the little feet are for the motor, there's a ring right there that actually, if you take those bolts out off, you can actually pull the blower wheel and the motor all in one piece. That way, if you can't get to the backside of the unit to get that set screw off, you can pull that ring off and then the whole wheel and everything will come out. And then you can get to that backside. You know, if you got shoved into a closet or something where it's, the unit's all the way against the back wall, you can't get to the back side of the unit to get that set nut of that nut off of there. So, or that set screw off of there, off that shaft. So there's like three or four bolts. You can pull it. The whole thing will come out and you can take the wheel off that way. All of our units, well, I say all, the majority of our units are using a Copeland scroll compressor, whether that be a single stage or a two stage unit. They're pretty efficient and reliable. They're pretty quiet as well. So we're using Copeland scrolls. We're really even using Copeland scrolls in our variable speed water to water unit. Now it's obviously a variable speed scroll compressor, but it is a scroll. The only unit I believe that we have that's using it not a scroll compressor is the horizontal unit, and it's got a reciprocating compressor, and it actually sits kind of sideways in the unit, and that's due to the size of the unit. We couldn't have that big compressor in there, so we do have a different type of compressor in it. There is an electric heater option on most units. The package unit, like the YT unit, has a place on the blower housing where there's actually the squirrel cage, and above it is a little plenum box with a square cutout. It's got a plate over it, but you can take that out and you can slide in a unit heater. The unit heaters come in 10, 15, and 20 kW. Just be kind of careful when you're sizing electric heat. I personally would not size an electric heater to cover the complete load of the home. Sometimes technicians don't hook up the L terminal on the thermostat, which is the lockout terminal. And so if the unit were to lock out in the heat pump mode and it switched over to electric heat, they may not even realize it if it's satisfying the needs of the home until they get their power bill. So then they want you guys to pay your power bill, their $900 power bill, because, you know, their geo wasn't working. So if you undersize it a little bit, it'll still keep the house, you know, maybe 65, but they're not going to be used to that. So they're going to notice that something's wrong. Also, I would recommend hooking up the L terminal to the thermostat and the unit. And that way, if there is a lockout, the thermostat will tell the homeowner a call for service. So always recommend hooking that L terminal up. Some of the units do not have the access for the internal heater. So we have duct heaters, as well as a heater on one type of package unit that'll basically sit on top of the unit and plug into the unit. So we have other options if it doesn't come with an internal heater, or you didn't order it with an internal heater, that we can put an external heater in as well. Some of the model nomenclature of our units, we'll just cover this real quick. The first digit is going to be either a G, a T, or an H, and that's the brand. So GeoComfort, Hydra Module, or Techco. Some of our commercial units will have an E there, and that E stands for Enertech. The commercial units, we're not branding those. So if you're a GeoComfort dealer and you get a commercial rooftop unit, it's going to have an E, not a G. The next is a type of unit. X happens to be a packaged unit. A C is a combination unit. You won't see H anymore. There might still be some out there, but we used to get the horizontal unit from another manufacturer. Now we make our own horizontal unit, and it's got a Z in there. So we won't see that H any longer. A W would be a water-to-water. S is a split unit, an indoor split, and R is an outdoor split or a retrofit unit. The next is the staging. S would be single stage, T would be two stage, V would be variable speed. The next is your tonnage of the unit or the unit capacity. So it's going to vary just depending on the type of unit we have. The next is a revision code. That's usually more for tech support. So if you call in and you've got a D revision, we know to make sure to pull up the D revision manual. Normally, when we change revisions, something major in the unit has changed. So maybe a compressor change, went from a K4 to a K5 compressor, or we've changed heat exchangers, but something major in that unit has changed. So that'll make sure that here in tech support, we've got the right manual and the right information we're looking at. The next is the voltage. We do offer quite a broad range of voltages just depending on the type of unit. You know, we have 208, 230 volt single and three phase. We got 460 volt three phase. Some units have 575 volt. Some of them have, we even have small units that are 115 volts. So it's just going to vary on the type of unit that you have. That's just the voltage code. The next digit is your D superheater, whether you have one or not, or if it's got the factory installed pump or not. Normally, residentially speaking, you're either going to have a zero or a one there. No D superheater, or D superheater with factory installed pump. If you have numerous units and you're using a bigger, like one single pump for all of these superheaters, then you could get the number five there, D superheater without factory installed pump. That's normally would be used on a commercial type application. The next is your return air option. So the XT is a multi-positional, so it'll go upflow or downflow. on the supply and left or right on the return. If it doesn't have a return, so like a split unit or a water-to-water unit, then there'll be an A there. Same thing on the discharge. Some units will have multi-positional and some will have dedicated, you know, top, back, end, side discharge. This is really going to depend on the type of unit. But again, if you see an A there, it doesn't have a supplied airflow on it. So split unit, water to water unit, that kind of thing. The next is your blower option. Some of the smaller units, horizontal units, you know, 1 ton, 1.5, you can order them with a ECM or a PSC motor. So we do have that option on some units. A lot of the vertical two-stage package units, they're all ECM blower motors on those. The next, obviously there's an A there if you don't have a blower in it. So water to water unit, split unit. The next would be the what type of heat exchanger. So you could have a C, an N, a B. I think there on a couple of units is also an option for the C would be a copper heat exchanger, coax. N would be a Cooper nickel coaxial heat exchanger. A B would be a brazed plate. And I'm not really sure what the letter is, but we also do have on some of the larger water to water units, a shell and tube heat exchanger or tube and shell heat exchanger. So I'm not really sure exactly what that nomenclature is, but that is an option on a couple of units. The very end, it'll have SS. That stands for standard stock. You could also have RS right there, which would mean it has a factory installed soft start, but that's usually some type of accessory that can be factory installed. That digit could change. Serial number overview, an example of a serial number that we have on our units are M15051111. So the first digit, the letter M, if you see that, that means it's built in Mitchell, South Dakota. All of our units, except for the air handler, are made in Mitchell, South Dakota. Now, the commercial units are not made in Mitchell, South Dakota, the large commercial units, but most units are built in Mitchell, so you'll have the M there. The next two digits are the year, so 15 would be 2015, and the next two are the month. So this is built in Mitchell in May of 2015. The 1111, those are a sequential number that are reset each month. That's the number of units in the month and the day. I'm not exactly positive on that, but you don't really need to cloud your mind with that. Just know that the first one is where it was built and the next two are the year and the two after that are the month. So pretty easy to know how old the unit is. General unit dimensions, we list these in all the manuals. That way, if you're needing ductwork to be made for the unit, you can look on here and see what the, you know, supply air, top discharge, what the dimensions of it are. So you can definitely check these out for getting all your ductwork together and that kind of thing. The physical data chart, it'll show you how much the unit weighs. It'll list your refrigerant charge amount. The refrigerant charge amount is listed on this chart. It's also listed on the data plate that's on the unit with your model and serial number. It's stamped on there. So if you need to add refrigerant, the easiest way to do it is to, you know, weigh it in. If you think it's low on charge, you can also weigh it out. And that way you know it's got the proper refrigerant charge in it or not. Always refer to the nameplate for the refrigerant charge in case for some reason you have a different manual. Maybe we talked about that revision code. Maybe that revision was changing the amount of refrigerant in it. So always refer to the nameplate And if you don't have, can't get to the nameplate, you're not real sure about what's in the manual, you can always give us a call and we'll double check that for you. We'll pull up a BOM or bill of material on that unit, and we can see how much refrigerant is based on your serial number. So whenever you do call in to tech support, try to have your serial number. We don't necessarily need the model number. With the serial number, we can pull up the model number, but it's nice to have that serial number so we can make sure we've got the right manual, and we can also create an incident once we talk to you. That way, if something, you know, we need to know about, it'll follow that unit. Unit location, care should be taken when the units are located in an unconditioned space. Obviously, excessive heat or freezing conditions could be adversely affect the unit. I wouldn't really recommend putting these in the unit, like a split unit or a horizontal or any type of unit, into like a damp crawl space. It'll start to rust things out prematurely and you'll have lots of issues. So just be careful where you're putting the unit. Serviceability is always priority number one. Of course, installers won't tell you that, but the unit at some time in its life is going to need to be worked on. So we would like a couple of feet all the way around the unit. Now, I know that's not possible in every install. So at a minimum, we would like to have the front of the unit and one side available in order to work on the unit. Now, if you've got to shove it into a closet, you got to shove it into a closet, but know that if you've got to change TXV or reversing valve or something like that, then you may have to pull the unit out of there to be able to work on it. So that's always a pain in the butt to do. So just try to make it as service friendly as possible. Again, don't use it during construction. It will void the warranty. Again, 2 foot suggested around the entire unit. Make sure you're setting the unit on an air or foam pad or some type of pad. And don't use the corner shims. We don't want to use corner shims because basically all the weight is in the bottom of that unit. If that compressor sits there and bounces up and down, over time, it's going to weaken that metal and that compressor could fall down through the bottom of the cabinet. So we want to support the complete base of the unit. So no corner shims, no blocks. Now you could set it on blocks, but you're going to have to set it on a whole pad above on those blocks. So just make sure we're setting it on the air foam pad. We do have a real nice rubber, like a 1-inch rubber, it looks like chewed up tires that are molded into a, you know, a 3-foot by 3-foot pad. That's real nice. It's not going to sag over time or anything like that. So that's another option that we have. The YT, XT, and CT are all multi-position field conversion on the return. So if you need to make it a left or right return, you just spin the unit from left to right. That's basically all you're doing. Your water lines will always be underneath the return side. So just keep that in mind. You will have to change the blower around if you want the blower head to be facing you. It's not the end of the world if you've got it on that backside. Just might be difficult to work on if you need to work on it. You can't get to that backside. So you may have to flip that around, but for a left or right return, you just spin the unit. The XT and CT, the XT package unit, the only reason we keep it around is because there is a downflow conversion kit. So you can turn it from an upflow to a downflow and it'll come with this little kit right here. It's basically some little ductwork that goes inside the unit, some insulation, basically the installs for the downflow kit. And it does have two different kits, one for the two and three ton and one through the 4-6 ton kit. So you will have to order this kit if you're going to go downflow. Here is the downflow kit installed. You can see normally the blower hangs from the top of the unit. It ends up getting flipped around, set down on it. There's a little plate that goes on the top of the unit to fill that hole in. And you can kind of see on the right side that blanket that's going around the ductwork. And then the ductwork goes down through the hole in that white box. It's in the very, very bottom of the unit. And then it'll output down through the bottom of the unit. I'm not gonna really get into a whole lot of duct sizing. We do normally size it for 400 CFM per ton, equal friction method. We do recommend that the first 12 inches off the top of the unit be a straight shot, no 90s or T's. And that's so we can get our airflow straightened up. And we do recommend insulating the plenum in the return for noise. Duct sizing calculator, again, we have these available. If you'd like one, you can let me know. I'll send you one, but I'm not really gonna get into duct sizing today. Kind of scroll through this kind of quicker here. We're not gonna talk about ductwork today. Here's what I wanted you guys to see. On the left picture is a gas-fired furnace. So the blower is normally in the bottom of the unit and it blows air through the heat exchanger out into the ductwork. Well, that heat exchanger also acts to straighten up the airflow. The airflow coming out of the blower wants to tumble. You can see on the right side on that geothermal unit that it wants to tumble when it comes out, so we don't get good airflow coming out. So we do like that 12 inches of ductwork. So it acts as kind of like the heat exchanger in a gas furnace, and it'll straighten that airflow up. So we get that laminar airflow through the heat exchangers. So in order for it not to tumble, we would like 12 inches of ductwork straight up before we go to any T's or branches or anything like that. Again, it's a recommendation. If you can't get it in there, you know, it is what it is. You may have issues down the line. We'll deal with that as we need to, but try to have that 12 inches of ductwork right above the unit. We like to have flexible duct connectors. You know, you can use that Duradyne flex connectors. We like to have that on supply and the return. That way, any kind of vibration in the unit is not transferred to the ductwork, especially if it's metal ductwork. If you're gonna have 90s, we would recommend large radius 90s with turning vanes. Again, these are recommendations. I know it doesn't happen a lot. A lot of times you're in a closet or something and that return duct just comes straight down. You got a hole cut in the side of the ductwork and it's right in the side of the unit. So sometimes you just gotta do what you gotta do in the field. And I definitely understand that. But if you got airflow noise issues, this is what we're gonna recommend, so. Make sure you've got a, we like to have a 4-inch throat on the return. If we've got a piece of, you know, square duct and with a hole cut in it and we're shoved up to the side of the unit, in the corners of that air coil, we don't get good airflow. So you could have hot spots or cold spots over time that could pop that coil and cause a refrigerant leak. So we do recommend a minimum 4-inch throat. A lot of times we'll use that throat area as well for the 1-inch return filter rack there. Electrical data, we do list all the electrical data in the manual. So if you need to size your wiring or make sure you got proper breaker sizing, if you're trying to size a generator for the home, the information is listed here. We'll usually look at lock rotor ramps for sizing a generator. Lock rotor ramps is normally 5x run load amps. If you're going to size a generator, you're normally going to need a soft start kit, which will lower the inrush current by about half. Otherwise, you have to have such a large generator, it's not really going to be cost effective. So anytime we're using a generator, we're going to have to use a soft start. So just keep that in mind. The electrical connections, they're gonna the incoming line voltage wires to L1 and L2. Again, all residential 208, 230 volt units are factory wired for the 230 volt operation. So if you've got 208, we need to switch that tap on the transformer. The flow center pumps, they don't get wired directly to the contactor. Now, if you put them there, it'll still work. But normally what we've got are a couple of wires coming off the T1, T2 side of that contactor, going through a couple 7-amp fuses that are resettable, and then going to a pump block inside the unit. There, that way the pumps are protected by the circuit break, the little 7-amp breakers. And that's why we would prefer that you wire your pumps in, your loop pumps in. The superheater pump, if you have a de-superheater on the unit, will be wired already into that pump block. So you can just kind of, there'll be a black and a red wire, I believe. So you can just wire your pumps in to that pump block. Thermostat wiring is pretty consistent, basically just like any other standard heat pump. R is your 24 volt power, C is your common, Y1 is your first stage of your compressor, Y2 is second stage of the compressor, and you've got your W1, which is your auxiliary. You can jumper it to E for your emergency heat. G is your fan, O is your reversing valve, and L is the lockout. I personally would not recommend using a setback thermostat, especially in the winter. If you get a thermostat outside, let's say you go to work, you set it back to 62 degrees, you come home 5 o'clock and you want it to be 70 degrees, when it sees that call come on, it's going to run the electric immersion or electric heaters as well as your heat pump anytime it's 3 degrees above set point. So what will happen is all that energy savings are going to be burned up by using that electric heat for half an hour while it heats up the home. Now, you could still use setback in the winter if you maybe disconnect or turn off the breaker to the electric heat strip. And you could just use your electric heat strip for emergency purposes. But in heating mode, if you've got the electric backup heat, I would recommend just setting the thermostat and leaving it alone. Obviously, we've got to have a heat pump thermostat. If you've got a split unit and you've got a gas furnace with an A coil on top of it, we will need to use a dual fuel thermostat, which if the furnace were to call the W call, it'll drop out the heat pump. The air temperature is too high and will lock out the heat pump anyway. So if you've got dual fuel, make sure you're using a dual fuel thermostat. When you have a fault lockout on the thermostats, you can tell your homeowner to turn off the thermostat and wait a minute and turn it back on, and the unit will try to restart. If you disconnect the high voltage power to the unit, the lockouts are erased from our lockout board. We don't have a memory on that board. So high voltage disconnect clears the faults on the board. If you go to the thermostat and turn it off and wait a minute, it'll still hold those codes on the board. That way, if the homeowner resets it and you go out there a couple days later, you'll still have the high pressure lockout or the low pressure lockout, whatever the lockout was, will still show up on the board. Because if the unit's running fine when you get there, it's kind of hard to know where to look if that lockout's been erased. So don't disconnect the high voltage. Don't tell them to disconnect the high voltage. Just go to the thermostat and reset it. If they reset it and it locks out again, then I would recommend that somebody take a look at it. If the homeowner resets it too many times, it's going to run and it's got a sequence of operation, and that heat exchanger could freeze up. Over time, they could freeze it so hard that it breaks it. So I wouldn't have them reset that unit more than about once or twice. Again, we do have the removable terminal strip that you can wiggle off there. It's kind of hard to get off there at first. Usually I just go to one end of it and try to get that end started, and then I go to the other end and wiggle it off, and then I can pull that terminal strip off of there. Again, I can send you one with some jumpers on it so you don't have to run up and down the stairs to check on that thermostat. You can jumper the unit out and run it. Just shoot me an email and I'll send that over to you. We do have accessory connections as well, and it's a removable terminal strip as well. The superheater piping, 1/2-inch copper piping, no PEX. Now you put PEX on there, you can do what you want, but we've had issues at times with even if a contactor were to weld shut, that these superheater will run and run and run and run and run. And it could get hot and melt that PEX over time. So that's why we say no PEX. 50 foot max, one direction, recommend insulating that piping. It does have 130 degree shutoff limit, basically. And it's a 230 volt pump. It's not connected from the factory down at the pump. It's got a little tag on it and a Molex connector letting you know, make sure it's got water in it and the pump shaft has been bled before you plug that in. It'll burn that pump up pretty quickly if you don't have water in it. It's a liquid cooled motor, so if it doesn't have fluid in it, then it's going to overheat and probably go out on internal overload first, and then it will one too many times on internal overload and it'll seize up. This is the superheater fitting kit that will come with the unit, and this is the how we're going to wire or how we're going to pipe that superheater in. We're going to tie into the cold water supply. I recommend putting a shutoff valve in so you can isolate it. Basically, there's going to be a little a T that comes with it, so you can tie it into that cold water line, pipe it into to the superheater, and then we're going to pipe into the water tank on the bottom of it. We'll give you a drain valve with it and a T and the shutoff there so you can isolate. If you've got a gas water heater, you're going to have to put a preheat tank in. We can't run the superheater straight to a gas water heater. You got to have a preheat tank and then run from the preheat tank into the gas water heater. Also, the superheater coax is a double wall vented heat exchanger. Basically, if the refrigerant were to breach, then it would be vented to the atmosphere rather than into the domestic hot water supply. We really don't want the homeowner drinking refrigerant water or taking a shower in refrigerant water. So that's double wall vented. So if you got a unit that's totally out of refrigerant and you can't find the leak, it's very possible it's coming out of a vent on the superheater. Yeah, it's basically on the end of it. There's just an opening and it'll just vent out of there. So if you see any oil around that area, more than likely it's coming out of that vent. So this is the preheat tank with a gas furnace or a regular or a gas water heater or standard water heater, but this is how we have it piped in, pretty much the same as a standard superheater circuit. And then we're just come off the hot water out of that tank number one and supply the tank number two cold water through it. So you can use a little, use it as a preheat tank. Just some of these superheater connections you can see. Obviously, we'd recommend putting the shutoff valves in. You may want to put pressure temperature ports too, so you can see what kind of flow you're moving through there. As long as you're under 50 foot and half inch copper, that pump that's in the unit will be able to handle it just fine. Again, the superheater pump wiring, again, it goes to this pump block, and it will have this big tag on it that says, hey, don't plug me in until the air has been bled and you've got water in the circuit. This is what happens when you run PEX and it gets too hot. This actually happened in a basement. And of course, the homeowner was on vacation in Florida, so it flooded their basement with like 2 or 3 feet of water. So by the time they got back and realized it. So this is why we don't recommend PEX. Condensate traps. We've got to have a condensate trap on all of our units. All of our units have a negative pressure air coil, so we're drawing air through the air coil. If you don't have a trap or a trap that has fluid in it, it'll pull air through the trap, and then it won't drain condensate until the blower shuts off. So if for some reason you get a condensate lockout and you get out to the unit and there's no water in the pan, make sure you got a trap and make sure that trap has fluid in it. We like to use these easy traps. We do sell them. I like them because they come with a little brush. The homeowner can flush those out a couple times a year if they need to. and they can also kind of see if it's getting blocked up. So it's kind of nice. Now, this little vinyl clear tubing here, if you've got it in a real warm mechanical area, it will sweat. It'll actually look like it's leaking water, but it'll actually just sweat. So you may have to insulate it. I've had to do it here in Greenville in one of our mechanical rooms because it actually looks like it's weeping water and leaking, but it's actually just condensate moisture. The electric heaters, again, I'm not going to get real in depth with these, but basically there's a couple different heaters. One that'll actually go right into the unit into the blower housing area. So you have to remove the upper panel there. There'll be a little box that you can pull the screws off of it. And there's a panel. That square panel will come off. You can slide that heater directly in. So if it's a right return, the heater will come with a left return. If it's a right return, we're gonna have to take it out. We're gonna have to spin it around. We're gonna have to spin those breakers around so the up is off and down is off for code. And then it'll just slide right in, flip it around, slide it in. And basically on the low voltage side of it, it'll just plug into our unit with a Molex connector. Then the high voltage, you'll run it from your breaker, obviously, and wire in those. It'll just slide right in. So it's a pretty easy, simple little step. You can see here is the little low voltage 6-pin Molex connector. There's only 3 wires to it, but it is a 6-pin connector for the low voltage. Auxiliary data there. This is a breakout of the 10 kW heater. We have a 10, a 15, and a 20. A 10 kW is just going to have one circuit breaker, 160 amp, and it's not staged. The 15 kW heater does have a time delay staging relay in it, and it'll have 2 breakers, a 60 amp and a 30 amp, a 60 amp for the first stage of 10 kW, and a 30 amp for the second stage of 5 kW. The 20 kW has 2 breakers in it, 2 60 amp, and the time delay staging relay, and it'll have a 10 kW first stage, 10 kW second stage. Now that time delay relay, it's basically, you can see over here to the right, it's an ICM digital time delay. It has dip switches all the way down it, 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, and so on. Basically, those are the amount of seconds before the staging kicks in. So if you have all the switches in the on position, it's about 17 minutes. So you can adjust it to however you need. It'll come with all of them in the on position and stage for that 17 minutes. So you can adjust that if you need to, and you may not need to, but it is a field selectable second stage heat source. So with that, that's basically all I've got today on the general unit installations. If you got any questions, you can ask today, or you can shoot me an email or give me a call. There's the technical services email address, as well as my personal email address. There's also a training email, which is training@EnertechGO. I get that email account as well. So you can, if you got training requests, you can shoot them there. You can shoot them to me, or you can call the 664-5860 number. You can ask for me, or you can talk to one of the guys back in tech support. But if you got any questions or comments, definitely reach out. And this webinar is recorded and will be uploaded later on today if you'd like to take a look at it again. So let me know if you need anything. If not, I know I went a little bit longer today than normal, but hopefully you got a little bit out of it today. And with that, we'll go ahead and end the webinar and have a great day, and hopefully see you again next week.